An abnormal heartbeat, either too fast, too slow, or erratically, affects 14.4 million people in the United States. These symptoms, known as arrhythmias, may be completely harmless, or they may be life-threatening. To help maintain a normal heartbeat, a pacemaker can provide a backup rhythm, while other new technology and studies at St. Francis Hospital continue to benefit patients and truly set the pace in cardiac care. More on this on today's episode of CHS Presents, Lifestyles at the Heart of Health. Hello, everyone, and thanks so much for joining us. I'm Jane Hansen. The Arrhythmia and Pacemaker Center of St. Francis Hospital has a proud history of pioneering new approaches to treating irregular heartbeats. Joining me now is the director of the center, Dr. Joseph Levine, who is a world-renowned arrhythmia expert, and he's going to tell us more about these life-saving devices that are out there and what's going on at St. Francis. You guys have been pioneers, and one of the things that's so interesting is how technology now is just advancing by leaps and bounds. What's the latest?
We have started the Arrhythmia Center approximately 30 years ago. And during that time, our field has evolved largely because of advances in technology. We were always taking care of patients with arrhythmias. Initially, some of the devices we placed, such as pacemakers, which have been around since the 1960s, were quite large and required major surgery for implantation. That's evolved over the years to smaller devices that can pace multiple chambers in the heart, and has more recently evolved using nanotechnology into wireless devices that can be implanted directly into the heart itself. Implantable defibrillators similarly have evolved from initial ones requiring open-chested and open-heart surgery to those now that can be placed just under the skin without any leads. And a lot of that also is due to technological advancements. So we've seen both advances in technology. We've also seen expansion of indications, whereas the initial defibrillator devices were placed only in patients and people who had experienced an episode of cardiac arrest and sudden death, but was lucky enough to be resuscitated, and only 1% of people are really successfully resuscitated across the United States. Even in cities where everyone knows CPR and there are defibrillators everywhere, the most success is only about 20%. And with the application of the technology has advanced to that small segment of people who survive cardiac arrest to be used in patients now who are at risk. And so we've evolved from so-called secondary prevention to primary prevention, opening up the technology to millions of people in the country.
Well, that's amazing. You just mentioned using nanotechnology. So I know that we've got some video of this teeny tiny little device. This is called what, the NanoStim?
This is a NanoStim. There are two wireless pacemakers that are available today. One is the NanoStim, which is being shown on the video. The other is a micro device, which is also available. These little pacemaker devices are about the length of a quarter and the caliber of a pen ink cartridge. They get implanted from a vein in the leg into the heart. The heart's beating, the catheter is advancing, and the actual device is actually screwed directly into the muscle wall of the heart. The machines have up to 20 years of life expectancy on their battery.
20 years?
Yep. And we've had remarkable success with them. They're not for everybody. They're only single chamber devices. Many of our patients require multiple chamber pacing, not just of the ventricle, which is shown on the video, but also the atrium. They're not yet quite ready for defibrillation without wires, but over the next 5 or 10 years, they're going to become multi-chamber devices, and they'll also eventually be married together with wireless defibrillators so that we no longer will have to operate on people.
That is amazing. So I know the defibrillators are kind of really close to your heart because you believe that they have become a major life-saving vehicle or production in this country. Explain to me how the latest ones are working versus what we used to have, because I know my father had one years and years ago.
The defibrillators used to be considered the size of a deck of cards. They're much smaller now. They're still primarily placed with wires, but there is a move toward wireless units, and some people have gotten wireless units. The technology is advancing, and our ability to interact with the machines are advancing. Our ability to understand what person benefits best from which technology is advancing. But we're very excited about the defibrillator. There are only a few things in medicine that make people live longer. When we take care of people, we ask them, can we make you feel better? Can we make you live longer? A lot of the things we offer make people feel better, but don't really affect a person's survival. Defibrillators prolong life in the right patients. And our center has been involved in many of the landmark studies through the 90s and 2000s, where we've shown the defibrillator in certain populations can reduce mortality by as much as 50 or 60%. And people are using the technology more and more, and it's an accepted technology, and patients themselves are happy with it. Many of them just feel more secure knowing that they have protection from these electrical catastrophes that can occur from heart disease.
Because a defibrillator really, it's like an electric shock or something, isn't it? Explain to me exactly what
Correct.
It is.
So you've seen on the television, on emergency shows, where somebody is rolled into an emergency room and they call for the paddles and they apply the paddles and the person jumps up and all of a sudden wakes up. These machines do it all automatically, all internally. It's been known for decades that that if one has an electrical instability, it can cause cardiac arrest and death. But it's also been known that if you reverse the electrical instability within the first 60 or 120 seconds, there's nearly 100% survival, and the arrhythmia is totally reversible. What the automatic defibrillator does is it allows that treatment to be delivered within that first 30 seconds. Without it, if somebody has a cardiac arrest, even if there's an automatic defibrillator in the area, and even if somebody is fully trained in CPR, it still takes minutes, precious minutes, to get the right therapy to the person. And so that in the studies done, even on airplanes or in casinos where they have these automatic defibrillators, half the patients don't survive. With automatic defibrillators, energy delivery is, as I say, within 30 seconds to a minute, and the survival from these electrical problems is nearly 100% for that episode. People don't live forever because they have heart disease and other issues, but electrical catastrophes don't cause sudden death. Since half of the mortality of a heart patient is electrical, we can prolong the life of a heart patient by preventing this type of mortality.
How do you know if you need a defibrillator?
Back in the early 1980s, there were some seminal studies done by Tom Bigger and Arthur Moss, which showed that the risk of cardiac arrest was related to how much scar tissue was in the heart. We measure scar tissue by something called an ejection fraction, which is the percent of blood that pumps with each beat. And what was found was that as the ejection fraction falls from a normal of 55% because of more scar to 40%, the sudden death rate remains relatively stable. But as the pumping fraction falls below that, the risk of sudden death goes up, and below 30%, it goes up exponentially. And the studies that we were involved with through the 1990s and the 2000s looked at people who had those lower ejection fractions, and in those studies, we randomly assigned people to either get a defibrillator or get best medical therapy, and there was a reduction in mortality in some of the studies by as much as, well, in all of them, by 30 to 60%. And based upon those studies, the real field of prevention expanded tremendously. And people now get defibrillators routinely if their ejection fractions are under 30 or 40%. The real challenge for us is to identify the people who have normal hearts, who have blocked arteries or other things where they might be affected by the same arrhythmic catastrophe as their first symptom, and that's going to be research for the future. Actually, statistically, if you have a weak heart, you have a higher chance of having cardiac arrest, but there's so many more people with normal hearts walking around that most of the cardiac arrests are still people with normal hearts, and we still have to tackle those people.
Sure, you don't know at first test or first challenge. We're going to take a break. Stay right here because we're going to do some more talking about all of this in just a minute. Be right back. Welcome back to CHS Presents Lifestyles at the Heart of Health. We're back with Dr. Joseph Levine, the director of the Arrhythmia and Pacemaker Center at St. Francis Hospital. And also joining us now is Dr. David Hawk, one of the center's leading electrophysiologists. And we're going to talk about something called ablation. But electrophysiologist, I mean, we keep talking about electricity and currents. I mean, that's what's going on with the heart and what you deal with every day, isn't it?
Yeah, we genuinely refer to ourselves as electricians of the heart, as opposed to the plumbing.
And those are the guys that fix the arteries.
And we attempt to help with all different arrhythmias, fast or slow.
Mm-hmm. So talk to me about what ablation is.
So ablation is a microcautery procedure. We're literally trying to burn a specific circuit or a series of circuits in the heart. They range from small areas that can cause tachycardia, where the heart will race very, very rapidly, to more diffuse areas that will burn for rhythms like atrial fibrillation. And there are many different rhythms that occur throughout life. You know, typical patients that we take care of range from 5 years old to 95 years old, all shapes and sizes. There are rhythms that present early in life. You talked about sudden death rhythms. There are certain rhythms called Wolff-Parkinson-Wright, a certain type of supraventricular tachycardia, the heart might race over 300 beats a minute, typically due to a small 3, 4, 5 millimeter area that can be targeted and microcauterized and cured over 95% of the time in about a half an hour type of procedure. There are many tachycardias that occur early in life where really impacted people's lives, where they're, you know, constantly at risk for having attacks where the heart suddenly will race 200 beats a minute. May stop them in their tracks. Again, most of those are due to very small areas. Mm-hmm. Later in life, there are more subtle symptoms that come up with rhythms. There are things like atrial flutter and fibrillation, where the symptom may be fatigue, shortness of breath, chest discomfort, some, you know, vague, you know, awareness of something
right.
going on.
And those you're feeling something, but it might not be as quite as dramatic.
Right, and unless you're actually recording it, sometimes you don't even know. And some of those rhythms are associated with significant events, including stroke, where we can microcauterize a bit larger areas. In the case of atrial flutter, maybe an inch or so. In the case of atrial fibrillation, which we might talk about, modify areas in the atrium of the heart.
So how do you do this? You're not opening up the heart. So what's the procedure like? Because you said it's very quick.
Right. So we enter the heart through veins in the leg or the neck. Sometimes we'll use an artery as well. Once we have an intravenous line in the vein, it literally takes 2 seconds to go from the leg to the heart, 1 second to go from the neck to the heart. Typically using the computers we have in the lab and with the experience we have at our center, it typically takes us anywhere from 5 to 10 minutes to identify the location of the circuit and another 10 or 20 minutes to really move the catheters in a very small area. The catheter itself that burns is effectively equivalent to a cautery catheter. Mm-hmm. Sometimes we freeze, but cautery is much more effective. But if you think about how accurate it is, it's a catheter which is only about 3 or 4 millimeters large, and it's like a branding iron. So wherever you put it, you create cautery, but it doesn't, the burn doesn't really extend very much from where you apply it. And so that's good news and bad news. The good news is we're doing this microsurgery through catheters where the person that doesn't even get a stitch to close a blood vessel, but we have to be right at the correct spot. So that's where the experience comes in. And our center is one of the most experienced doing it. We've been doing ablation. I've been doing ablation since 1985. Between us, we've probably done 15 or 20,000 ablations. We have success rates for SVT and Wolff Parkinson White that exceed 98 or 99%. And the procedures are very safe, safer than going on a treadmill test.
When you talk about SVTs, this is really referring to this kind of sudden death thing, particularly that we might see in teenagers or young adults,
correct. So
right?
Wolff Parkinson White causes sudden death in about 4% of people. SVT, it's much less common, but it's the sudden onset of rapid palpitations that plague people on and off throughout their lives. It can first present during pregnancy or during the hormonal start and puberty, but it can present when someone's in their 70s or 80s as well, and it's a sudden onset of rapid heartbeats, 150 to 250 beats a minute usually. With Wolff Parkinson White syndrome, we've had people clocked as high as 500 beats a minute in our hospital.
Whoa.
And so that can be quite dangerous. But most of these, it's for lifestyle. Some people with panic disorder have SVT, and you cure the SVT and their panic disorder goes away. So sometimes it's an underdiagnosed condition or misdiagnosed condition. So it's really for that kind of person. And I'd say mostly that procedure is done for lifestyle and improvement of symptoms as opposed to necessarily prolonging life, which is where the defibrillators really have more of a role.
So when you talk about ablation, then, that you've done it since the mid-1980s, it must have changed since hasn't it?
As Joe was talking about before with devices, the marriage of, I mean, we really are very appreciative of the marriage of technology and medicine has been wonderful in terms of just micro-mapping, mm-hmm. in terms of just delivery of energy in a safe way. There are things called irrigated catheters that allow the less scar formation that Joe was talking about, so there's not a lot of collateral injury to tissues you don't specifically want to target. There's been, the last 3, 4, 5 years, has been what's called contact force that's really allowed us to go from ablating, say, just the tip of a pen to kind of like ablating areas the size of a whole pen by being certain at each point that you're delivering the right. It can literally measure the force per point exactly point by point so that you can righteously cauterize the right amount, mm-hmm. you know, based on the signals and based on this mm-hmm. pressure measurement.
Before that technology, we would guess. And if you push too hard on the catheter can perforate the heart. If you push not hard enough, it doesn't work. So, you know, we would find the right common medium, but we would be obviously cautious. And with the newer technology, we can be much more self-assured. And this is technology that's in the tip of a catheter, which is the size of a tip of a pen, and it's smart enough to measure the force against the wall no matter what angle the catheter is sitting. That's how smart it is, and that's really all nanotechnology. And that's occurred in the last few years. The other thing that's really advanced, when we first started doing the procedure, we were literally slaves to the X-ray machine looking to see where the catheter was. Now we have the equivalent of GPS of the heart where there are sensors on the catheter. And just like a GPS, the satellites triangulate where your car is, we can actually triangulate where the catheter is in a beating heart within 1 millimeter tolerance. And so that's allowed us to go almost X-ray free for some of these procedures.
I was about to ask that because X-rays can be... Yeah, dangerous.
X-rays themselves can be harmful, and something a person who is contemplating one of these procedures, a potential patient or a patient who has one of these conditions, they really need to make sure they're in a place where the people are very sophisticated and experienced, because lesions put in the wrong place can cause complications, and taking too much X-ray can cause complications, and there are all of these competing technologies out there, and some of them are just better than others, and mm-hmm. a person really needs to be a smart consumer as they choose who they want to go to, where they want to have it done, and what kind of procedure they want.
Well, I understand that you need to be a smart consumer, but if you're a consumer who's got something going on with their ticker, and how do you know? How would the average person know? Well, how do you determine that?
And most of the time, I don't want to make it too simplistic, but it is like what a monkey does. You know, when you've done large numbers of the same thing, then you know how to do that. You know, the micro manipulation is all well and good if you've done 500 of that exact spot. And I think that's been the privilege for us at working at a heart center and with really dedicated staff. We've really been able to reproducibly
To show that you guys know what you're doing and that you've got a lot of experience.
But from the consumer standpoint, I think the consumer should be a consumer. Ask the doctor, how many have you done? What's your success rate? What's your complication rate? What are you worried about for me in particular? How are you going to protect me in there? What's your main goal here? Is it me or is it the procedure? Mm-hmm. And I think a person has to be a smart consumer. And if a doctor shies away from answering those questions,
that should be a red flag.
They should run away. Okay. And the doctor should be able to give you the exact statistics, because we're all graded by it, by the hospital accreditation boards,
sure,
and the hospitals collect the data.
There's places to look.
That's exactly right.
We're going to take a quick break. Our discussion will continue right after this. Welcome back to CHS Presents Lifestyles at the Heart of Health. We're back with Drs. Levine and Hawk, arrhythmia experts at St. Francis Hospital. And now, of course, we're continuing our discussion. What I'm curious about is telemedicine, remotes, all of that in this whole area that you're talking about of arrhythmia. What's the latest on that?
It's interesting history at St. Francis. Actually, one of our partners who passed prematurely, Dr. Steve Greenberg, actually pioneered the first. It was actually referred to as wireless monitored pacemaker on Long Island, probably now about 10 years ago. And it's allowed remote monitoring. In the past, it was a cumbersome thing to check devices that we put in the pacemakers and defibrillators we talked about. People would often just have to come into the office where there were these cumbersome telephone devices where it would be a 10, 15-minute phone call, which the patient might make once every 2 or 3 months. The wireless monitoring is a radio frequency based communication. You have a monitor at home that plugs in and automatically checks the device literally on a daily, hourly basis. And if something is picked up, it will go to a central station, kind of like a home alarm, mm-hmm. and it will be processed and we will get alerted that something is wrong. So it's transformed a situation where we were able to check the devices 3-4 times a year in a rather cumbersome fashion to now 365 day a year checking. And that's really allowed pick up in advance any lead or device problems that previously might have resulted in problems.
Right, but the nanostim that we were talking about earlier, that has no leads on it, right? And so I guess what I'm wondering is, a device that's actually put inside the body, is there a way of almost having that like a cell phone or
yes.
something?
Yes. So what David is talking, the nanostim isn't quite ready for that kind of wireless communication, but the defibrillators that are inside have literally millions of different programmable options. And they all have the ability to pick up and record arrhythmias that people are having, and they have ability to self-test themselves. And again, as David said, let's say somebody has atrial fibrillation where there's a risk of stroke and you see a person once every 6 months. Well, meanwhile, that person's lived with that risk of stroke over the 6-month time frame and nobody knew about it. Now, through a base station that sits next to the bed that talks to the machine under the skin at night automatically, it'll actually run the information through a set of algorithms, and if an abnormality is found, it notifies us by email within a few days or within a day. So it's not real time, but it has allowed the communication period to shorten from 6 months down to a day or so.
But what is that based on? Again, is it all batteries?
Radio waves.
It's radio waves.
Correct.
Okay.
So now, the other thing is also the other part of telemedicine is a diagnostic part. Mm-hmm. And so that there are now monitors, so somebody might have a particular circumstance, they might have fainting spells or they might have palpitations or the like. There are monitors now that communicate, again, over the internet via cell phones or via implanted units that then talk to these base stations that can transmit arrhythmias that are either picked up because they didn't meet the right algorithm that the that's deemed normal, or because a person felt something and activated the machine. So what it's allowed us to do is literally take our diagnostic tools and transform them and from being office-based to being available pretty much anywhere that there's internet. And that's really made patients' lives easier. It's improved safety. Some of these home monitor devices have been associated with improved survival, and it's clearly improved our ability to diagnose arrhythmias.
What do you see in, happening in the future? Visionary, what's out there?
Well, we talked about devices going completely wireless, you know, to avoid entering through the vascular system. I think the ablation, the whole heart, you know, is going to be approachable. You know, there'll be more ventricular tachycardia ablations, which we haven't discussed so far, but it'll allow for, you know, the three-dimensional, very precise mapping with all sorts of ancillary tests that go with it will allow us to micro-manipulate catheters in even more precise and diffuse ways so that we can cure a lot of ventricular tachycardia.
Which is what is
that? That's the real sudden death rhythm that we talked about having the defibrillators for. So an ideal future would be where you don't need the defibrillator and you could cure the ventricular tachycardia. Right now, the defibrillator is the perfect protector,
right?
But it doesn't really eliminate the risk of shock. So what Joe was talking about, you know, if we had a really perfect defibrillator, there's millions of people dying suddenly, you know, in the world every year. The defibrillator would save them, but you still wouldn't eliminate the target site.
And you, quickly, what would you think would be the great vision out there?
I think that we're going to get to a place where we're going to be able to identify the people who need the treatment and who don't need the treatment. So we have this safety net that acts as like a fire insurance policy. You never want your house to burn down, but if it burns down, you want to be insured. Well, we insure with fire insurance many, many more people than houses burn. If we could pick the one house that's going to have the problem, then we can save all of that expense and all of that potential complication from the rest of society. So if we could, if we can make better diagnoses, I think that we'll be able to target our therapy more directly, and I really think that's going to make the big difference in the future.
Well, congratulations on the fabulous work that both of you do at St. Francis. It's obviously you've saved hundreds, if not thousands of lives, and continue doing so. Continue, keep at it. Thank you very
much for being here.
And as always, for more information or to schedule an appointment with Catholic Health Services, simply call 1-855-CHS-4500 or you can go to chsli.org. Thanks so much for joining us today. I'm Jane Hansen, wishing you goodbye and good health.